exclusive group of lawyers, and so he wanted some feedback on how, I mean, what are the lawyers' grievances and what they think of what is happening in the country. It's also appropriate that we are meeting in this institution, which is named after a great Tamil patriot, Vavusi Chidambaram Pillai, who not only was a lawyer, but also was jailed and convicted for sedition. So it is appropriate that we meet here in these times, because, why was he convicted for sedition? He was convicted because he challenged the corporate hegemony of the British Raj at that time by starting the Swadeshi Steamship Company. And when he came back to practice after that, he was, I mean, almost in penury. So that's a story familiar to Tamilians and this thing. So anyway, without much ado, I'll hand over the mic to Mr. Chandramohan, the legal head of the Tamil Nadu Congress. He will say a few words of welcome.
உங்கள் சார்பாக நமது பாரத வருங்கால பாரத பிரதமர்களை வரவேற்கிறேன். உங்கள் சார்பாக நம்நாடு காங்கிரஸ் கட்சியினுடைய தலைவர் சொற்பவர் வீரர் அழகிரி அவர்களை வரவேற்கிறேன். I welcome our eminent and beloved young leader, Sri Rahul Ji, AICC General Secretary Dinesh Gundurav Ji, AICC Secretary Sangai Jalji, Stival Prasad Ji, our Honorable Tamil Nadu Congress Committee leader, Sri K.S. Alagiri Ji, Executive Chairman, Executive President, Mr. Jayakumar Ji, மோகன்ஜி, விஷ்ணு பிரசாத்ஜி, மாணிக் தாகூர்ஜி, ஆண்டரபல் எம்பி செல்லக்குமார்ஜி, ஆண்டரபல் எக்ஸ் தமிழ்நாடு டிஎன்சிசி பிரசிடன்ட் மிஸ்டர் திருநாவுக்கரசுஜி, இவிகேஎஸ் இளங்கோவன்ஜி, தங்கவேல்ஜி, தனுஷ்கோடி ஆயத்தன்ஜி, யூத் காங்கிரஸ் ஸ்டேட் லீடர் மிஸ்டர் அசன்ஜி, மகிழா காங்கிரஸ் லீடர் மிஸ்டர் சுதா, ஆர்டிஐ பிரசிடன்ட் மிஸ்டர் கனகராஜ், மை டியர் சீனியர் அட்வொகேட்ஸ், senior leaders of the Congress Party, my dear beloved sisters and brothers of legal fraternity, I will welcome to you. I thank our leader for this opportunity to meet our legal fraternity. I would like to say that this soil is meant for brave warriors of freedom struggle, like Vavu Chidambaram, called as Vavusi, was a eminent lawyer starting shipping trade to break the trading of East Indian Company trading. Now we are facing monopoly trading of few friends of present Prime Minister. The combined Tamil Nadu district is known to freedom movement. Worth mentioning the few ancient leaders: Veerapandiya Kattabomman, Vavusi, Vanjinathan, Mahakavi Bharathi, Sri Subramanya Siva, and the list continues. We are proud to assemble here to initiate another movement to secure the democracy. This college is name of the freedom fighter Vavusi. Our leader Rahul Ji, your great grandfather Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru Ji visited this college in the year 1959. Your grandma Srimati Indira Ji came to this college in the year 1972 for VOC centenary celebration. Madam released the Vavusi stamp and gave roaring speech. Your father Rajuji came to this college and registered his memorable speech in the year 1989. I remind that the principal of this great college, historical college, has met you at Trichy Airport in the year 2015 and invited to you to this institution. Sometimes dreams come true. Yes, I am proud to say that worldwide two well-known families are there. One is Queen Victoria family and the other one is all time great Pandit Jawaharlal Nehruji family. Today the fourth generation of the most respectful family of our country is visiting this college. It is yet another historical moment. The role of lawyer is freedom movement is a great sacrifice. Most of the eminent lawyers had sacrificed the noble profession, personal life, and involved in freedom struggle to save the country and build to constitutional democracy. Today, the democracy setup is in danger that it is without consulting the legislator and the concerned people, laws and amendments were made. We think that last resource of the common public is judiciary. We there, the lawyers, have taken few attempts here and there to save the judicial system built our predecessors. Our leader Rahul Ji has told that today freedom of judicial discipline is like a pendulum. Independent investigation agency, CBI, CVG, CAG, etc. become proud pipe of the ruler. Martinize and modernize is mantra of modern trading, that is purchasing of legislatures as done in so many states, likewise Goa, Madhya Pradesh, recently Pondicherry also. Our Prime Minister is privatization public sectors for the welfare of Anis Group, Ambani and Adani. Indian economy is under the decision of few friends of Honorable our Prime Minister Modi ji. During the COVID-19 pandemic, 90 to 97% of the lawyer all over the India found it very difficult to find their livelihood. Even the state and the central government were very silent on this issue. But the Bar Council of Tamil Nadu and Puducherry voluntarily contributed the need of lawyers' family. Rahul ji, this lawyers fraternity extended our fullest support to our leadership to save our constitutional system and our nation. I thank Rahul ji and the management of the college, Sri APC Sokalingam and APC Sanmugam for this opportunities. Once again, I welcome one and all. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Can I invite Mr. Gandhi to give some opening remarks?
Dinesh Gundurao ji, K.S. Alagiri ji, K.R. Ramaswamy ji, P. Chitambaram ji, Advocate Chandra Mohan ji, senior leaders, advocates, I'd like to welcome all of you here, and I would like to thank you for inviting me here. It's an honor for me to have a conversation with you. Can I use that mic? It's an honor for me to come here today and have a conversation with you. I've come more to listen to you than to tell you what I think. So I think there will be questions you will be asking me and opinions that you will be giving me. I'm looking forward to hearing those. I'll start by saying two or three words in the beginning. A nation is a balance between its institutions. If that balance is disturbed, the nation is disturbed. That is the central idea. What are the institutions that make up the Indian nation? There are elected institutions, Lok Sabha, Vidhan Sabhas, Panchayats. There is the judiciary. There is a supporting free press. These institutions together, they hold the nation in place. And what we have seen over the last 6 years is a systematic attack on all these institutions. Democracy does not die with a bang. It dies slowly. And I'm sad to tell you that democracy in India is dead. It doesn't exist anymore. It is dead because one organization,
the RSS has combined with huge finances to penetrate and disturb and destroy our institutional balance. That is what has happened. There are many, many different manifestations of this. Misuse of sedition law, killing of people, threatening of people. These are all symptoms of the problem. But the problem is that concentration of capital has combined with the organization of the RSS and has disturbed, and I would say actually destroyed, the institutional balance in the country. There are multiple other balances that have also been destroyed. Remember that India is a union of states. So all the states come together to form the nation. When you destroy the institutional balance of the country, you also destroy the negotiation between the states. Because if all the states do not have equal say, then the power balance between those states is disturbed. And that is a serious problem for any country. This is what we are facing. And I think the spirit of this meeting is to understand what is happening and to defend the Indian nation and India's institutions from this brutal assault that is taking place. And I think that is why we are having this conversation today. Please feel free to give me your opinions and your questions.
So we have some questions. Hello? There's some questions which are this thing. So can I call V.A. Krishna Kumar?
I always have a question, especially when I used to be working in Uttar Pradesh in campaigning, and it's really hot, and I have the luxury of sitting in, coming here in a shirt, and you have to wear this suit and shirt and all this. So I'm feeling hot just looking at you. Sorry.
Mr. V.A. Krishna Kumar.
After BJP came to power, they have either purchased the MLAs or threatened the MLAs by NIA, CBI and income tax. And that's why the MLAs are switched over to BJP. Though the people give full minded to the Congress MLAs, but because of this threatening, they have switched over their loyalty to BJP. This is what happened recently in Pondicherry. So my question is whether the state leaders fails to choose right persons for MLA candidates and how to curb this.
The choosing the right MLA candidate, please sit. Choosing the right MLA candidate is just one component of the problem. If we look at Madhya Pradesh, attempt in Rajasthan, Goa, attempt going on in Jharkhand, Pondicherry, Arunachal, these are all Congress governments. These are all governments where people gave the mandate to us. And concentration of capital took the mandate away from us. I know the amount of money that was thrown at the MLAs in Madhya Pradesh. I know the amount of money that was thrown at the MLAs in Rajasthan. We are talking massive amounts of money. Right? And so when you have one party that is fighting the election with thousands and thousands of crores, and you have other political parties that are not allowed to raise finance, that financiers who would like to support opposition parties come and say that look, we understand what you're standing for, we support what we are standing for, but if we give you 1 rupee, our business will be destroyed. I've had that conversation where they say we want to support you, but if we support you, it means that our business will be destroyed and so we cannot support you. So on one side, you have capture of all institutions. You have a monopoly on finances. You have a monopoly on the media. And on the other side, you've got political parties that are not allowed to compete. When they form governments against all odds, their mandates are taken away from them. So, where is this heading? It is, see, as a political person, as a political leader, normally, in a democracy, I require institutional support. I require a media that is objective. I require a judiciary that is aggressive. I require the ability to speak in the Parliament House. All those have been taken away from us. I'm telling you, we are not allowed to speak in Parliament. Literally, we're not allowed to speak in Parliament. So where is this heading? There is only one way this thing is going to get resolved, and that is mass action. When the ordinary citizen of this country realizes that this country now is not being run by his mandate, but is being run by force, is being run undemocratically. And that is where this is going. And you can see this beginnings of this mass movement, you can see it. It's in the borders of Delhi when they pass the farm laws. So the stirrings are there. But as a political person, in my entire career before 2014, I had never imagined a situation where I will have no institutional support whatsoever. So I've given you a long answer because, frankly, even if we put in the right MLAs in place, it's not enough. Because the power is so high, strong and so heavy that even that MLA will not be able to sustain it. And then the question arises, what happens after we come to power? What happens? Because there is full penetration of all the institutions. There is penetration of the judiciary. There is penetration of the media. There's penetration of the bureaucracy. So what do we do once we come to power? Because we're going to have to deal with 15 years of judges who have been placed into the judiciary because they support one political party. So this is going to be a huge challenge for this country going forward.
There's also a related question from VZ Victor about the anti-defection law. Mr. Victor in the audience.
Was any law can be made to amend the anti-defection law? I mean, in case MLAs are just going to different parties, but I just want to say, the voters are voted only for our party, but MLAs are shifted to different parties, but we want to say the particular MLAs and MPs should not be allowed to go to different parties. They should be disqualified at the early stage itself.
Yes. I mean, you can make the anti-defection law stronger, you can disqualify them, but remember one thing. In order to do that, you need parliament. And you're not going to get parliament right now.
Yes, sir.
So I agree with that idea. But again, even to enforce that idea, we need the institutional structure. We don't have it. So now India is entering a phase very much like when we were fighting the British, that we cannot rely on the institutions to protect our democracy anymore. There is only one place where we, on whom we can rely, and that is the people of the country. There's no other place. And I say this with all seriousness, because I've been dealing with this problem, and I firsthand see the depth of this problem. Absolutely, we should have laws that don't allow MLAs to move. But first, we need a functioning parliament. We need a judiciary that's not completely penetrated by the RSS and the BJP. We need a press that raises this issue and says, listen, look, our Madhya Pradesh government goes, and it is essentially bought. Nobody in the media says anything. Our government in Arunachal goes, it is bought. Nobody says anything. We need today, if the Congress party wants to win an election, the only way to win the election is if it has a two-third majority. If it wins the election by 10, 15 seats, it's not a win, it's a loss. Because BJP just comes, buys the people and has its own government. That's what we are facing. And I'm sure you're also feeling it in your work. And you can see it in the nation. As people who are questioning and challenging the RSS, BJP are threatened, pushed around. I'm lucky. I'm lucky because there is nothing that they have on me. That's why I'm lucky. Because I had the good sense, through my whole political career to be an honest person. That's why they can't touch me. There's nothing they can do to me. Right? That's why I can speak to you. Because no ED, no CBI, no nothing is going to affect me. And that's also why, by the way, that 24/7 the BJP attacks me. Because they understand very well that this man is not corrupt and we have no leverage on this man.
Okay, next question is from K. Raja Prabhakaran, advocate from Madurai. Is he here in the audience?
Respected sir, there is a provision in the Industrial Dispute Act about the unfair labor practice, right? Employing the employee for more than 8 hours duty and employ him and accompanying him in other than the recruited and appointed post. And there is a provision also in punishing the employee. But till date.
In punishing the employer.
Employer, yeah, I have corrected, yes. Till date, not even the press, or not in the press, not a single employee is punished under this act. Can we discuss this point in parliament for effective implementation of this act?
I'm happy to discuss that in parliament. We can do that, and I'll raise it for you if you want. It is also an indication of the concentration of power in this country. It's an indication of the concentration of finance in this country. Look, essentially, as I said in parliament, four people are running this country. Four. Right? That's all. Hum do, hamare do. And everywhere these four people's imprint is there.
Yes, Ms. Vanaja is here. Questions?
Na vandu Tamil pesna. Dr. Slar and Abhi vandu edha oru political parties first vaangite avanga mele mele vandranga. அதுல இதுல என்ன சிக்கல்னா ஜட்ஜஸ் வந்து ரிட்டையர்மெண்ட் ஆனதுக்கு பிறகு பொலிட்டிக்ஸில் வந்தீங்கன்னா மக்களுக்கு என்ன விதமான ஒரு நியாயம் கிடைக்கும் அதான் என்னுடைய
Question is about post-retirement sinecures for judges. They accept political appointments from the government after they retire.
Yeah. And we've seen examples of this where judges take decisions that the government wants and then they're given plum posts. Would you like to just translate that? Would you just like to translate it for her?
She can
answer. Oh, okay. So, and we've seen examples of this. I think at a minimum, we should have a cooling off period of a certain amount of years where judges cannot be given these type of posts. At a minimum. Because otherwise the whole incentive structure is in question. If the judge is going to be given a plum post after 3 or 4 cases, it will influence how he takes those decisions. So I think at a minimum we should do that. What would you like?
I agree.
But would you like to add anything to what I said?
No.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Okay.
Next question is from S. Annadurai, Advocate Rani Pet.
Sir, your views on women reservation bill in parliament and assemblies.
My view is reflected in this room. I'm having to look carefully. 1, 2, 3. I'm having to look very carefully to find the ladies. And I think that in every institution in our country, we need to have more women and we need to give them more space. So I'm fully for women's reservation. I would like to see more and more women in the judicial system. And of course I'm for women's reservation in parliament and Vidhan Sabhas. You need more than reservation. Indian men need to change the way they look at Indian women. And we can keep doing reservation. But unless Indian men start to view Indian women with the same lens that they view themselves, the real change is not going to happen. You agree with me? No? So I think it is also it's giving women positions, creating the atmosphere where women can get the positions, but it is also changing our attitude. And it's not only in the judicial system, it's across the country, in every space. Because women, with all due respect to my brothers here, women in India are treated very badly by men.
Okay, the next question is pertinent to all of us here about laws delays by Z. Rizwan Hussain.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
And we see that many cases are pending in the courts, millions of them. And litigants spend their entire lifetime running from pillar to post, expecting justice, sometimes 2 generations, 3 generations. So in my opinion, there must be a process where justice can be given speedily. So when you come to power, God willing,
I mean,
how do you plan to deal with this?
You probably understand the judicial system. All of you understand it better than I do. But as an outsider looking in, I think increasing the number of judges would be one thing that would be useful. Making sure that at the lower levels, our judicial process moves faster, that would be another thing we could do. What are the type of things that you would suggest?
Yeah, there should be some time limit for the cases. And judges, more judges, like you said, and also appeal process. So there is a lot of appeals. So this should be shortened so that people can get justice.
Yeah.
So this is what I think.
Why are there so many appeals?
I think that's an opportunity given. Appeals are because there is dissatisfaction on
right.
the judgments.
So it just goes on, it drags
yes.
the whole process
yes.
on.
So there are a lot of loopholes that are exploited.
Right.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. But do you think that we need to sort of look at the judicial system and have a sort of broader reform of the judicial system?
Yes, that's necessary.
That we should sit down and sort of once and for all sort of do some big picture things to the judicial system?
Yes, and I'm sure that will happen when you come to power.
Well, we'll try.
Yes, we are with you.
Thank you.
Okay, there is a question related to this on the Indian Judicial Service, whether it should be there, from A. Brahma.
In our nation, the administrative side, IAS, IFS, IRS, but in judicial side, IJS, Indian Judicial Service. So, a lot of youngsters will come to the power to the people. But in judicial side, give an opportunity to the directly come to forward to manner to the youth, form a IJS. Indian Judicial Service. So you come to power, please do this.
I think as a supplement to the other streams, I think that might be a good idea, and it's something that we could consider.
Thank you.
We could
Thank
look
you. Thank you. Lot of thanks.
I'm told we have time for two more questions. This is a very frequent question you might be getting on electronic voting machines. About this, this is a question from M. Barnabas.
Dear Rahulji, I want to ask a question that the electronic voting machine is dropped in so many developed countries. but in our country still using that machines, even though it is malpracticeable. Are you accepting it? What is your opinion?
Look, EVMs, as you said, the world over have been shown to have problems. Many developed countries refuse to use them because they feel that they are open to manipulation. One of my biggest issues with the EVMs is that the Election Commission doesn't give us access of the type we would like to study those machines. Whenever the Congress party has asked, show us the machine, let us look at the machine properly, let us do random checks on the machine, we are told you can't do that. So I would be comfortable with the EVM if I could see that it was open to checking, that it was transparent, that it was accessible to political parties. That's the first thing. Fundamentally, I'm not entirely convinced myself that EVMs are 100% secure. I don't believe that. I think there are problems with EVMs. But a first step can be the Election Commission saying, okay, political parties are having doubts about these machines. We will give them full access to the machines, to look at the machines, to study the machines. And we will allow random checking of machines by neutral observers. That they don't allow. Then it makes me wonder. Then I start to ask the question, why are they not making this machine transparent?
Thank you.
Okay, there are also other questions about the present laws. This is from Advocate Jijish from Tiruchirappalli Bar Association.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
What is your personal opinion about CAA Act and protest against Hamas?
We think the CAA is discriminatory. And we don't. We don't agree with it, we don't support it. It's discriminatory on many counts. On the farmers' acts, these acts are designed to wreck the Indian agricultural system and hand over the benefits of that agricultural system to two or three big corporates in India. The first law is designed to destroy the markets, farmers' markets. The second law is designed to allow as much hoarding as the largest corporates in the land want. And the third law basically says that if a farmer contests, then the farmer cannot do it in a court of law. So we are completely against these three laws. We do, however, feel that the system, agricultural system, needs to be looked at and it needs to be reformed. But the reform cannot be done by destroying the system. And if any reform is going to be done, the stakeholders of the system, the farmers, laborers, small traders, they have to be involved in a discussion from which the reform will evolve. So we're against these farm bills, and we are protesting against it. We are fighting it across the country.
One more question on secularism. These will be the last questions we are taking because Mr. Gandhi has to proceed for his next function. So, from ex Selvam Sounder.
Sir, secularism is the basic structure of our constitution. Sir, now the minority institutions are facing very often facing problems. Sir, do you think there is a danger to the secularism in our country now?
There is a full-scale assault on secularism in this country. And the RSS and the BJP are leading that assault. You said secularism is a foundation of our constitution. It's much more than that. Secularism is the foundation of our culture and our history. If you go back into time, you will see that this country has always been a sensitive, compassionate country that embraces different types of ideas. So this is not just an attack on the constitution, it is an attack on our history and on our culture as well. And I think it is very important that it is stopped in its tracks. And that all of us fight this assault. I think, you know, in the beginning I told you that our institutions are under attack, our nation is under attack. But I must tell you that I believe that you are the people who work in the judiciary, the lawyers, the judges, who have a very, very important role to play. Just like we have an important role to play, just like politicians have an important role to play, you also have a very important role to play. Stand up. If you stand up to
for attending and interacting with us, we assure the Congress subdelegates assure G, we are ready to give our life for this nation. Please salute to you. All of thanks, all. The Congress advocates as well as the chairmen of this party. We thank you all. Thanking you.